On This Week in Enterprise Tech, we've got Vijay Balasubramaniyan from Pindrop Security, CEO and founder, to tell us about call security. Quiet on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twit. This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 136, recorded April 17th, 2015. Pindrop Security. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Casper, an online retailer of premium mattresses for a fraction of the price. Because everyone deserves a great night's sleep. Get $50 off any mattress purchase by visiting casper.com/twiet and enter promo code TWIET. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 50-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidate fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/twiet. That's ZipRecruiter.com/twiet. And by Dropbox for Business. Dropbox for Business lets your team sync and share files just like Dropbox. And you can connect Dropbox for Business with over 300,000 apps for project management. Visit dropbox.com/business for a free 14-day trial. That's dropbox.com/business. Welcome to Twiet This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. And of course, I'm joined by my co-host, I'm not sure exactly what a co-host is, but starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, welcome back, Mr. Geek in Paradise.
And welcome back from the wilds of Kihei. And nice sharp utilities pair of scissors trying to get cleaned up. But we have power monitors on Kihei. Put on your foil hats.
I have one anyways. Speaking of foil hats, a man who actually has a foil dress, I've actually seen it, Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, welcome back to the show.
Thanks, Padre. It's great to be here, courtesy of the nice folks at the Marriott Residence Inn near the Orlando International Airport.
Well, gentlemen, we've got an absolutely action-packed show today. We've got Vijay Balasubramaniyan. I'm really bad with that, but I'm going to get that eventually. He's the CEO and founder of Pindrop Security. But before we get to him, what do you say we go ahead and jump into the blips? This first one, well, it's all about the AT&T going after the FCC. Now, in a surprise move, AT&T has itself filed a legal challenge against the FCC's net neutrality rules. This isn't a surprise because it's a lawsuit, but rather because most analysts thought that the telcos and ISPs would use intermediaries to launch the first wave of lawsuits. It's also surprising that AT&T is the lone big-ticket ISP going against the FCC, along with four consortiums and a small ISP in Texas, without, currently, the support of Comcast and Verizon. A long legal battle is expected, though it is interesting that a recent broadband report showed that the planned broadband deployment and network capital expense, two areas in which net neutrality opponents said net neutrality would kill the moment it was passed, have actually increased by some 19% in the less than 2 months since its passage.
Android is ready for work. Now, whenever you talk about smartphones and tablets in the enterprise, you hear the letters MDM. Now you can hear administrators talk about MDM and Android in the same breath with no foul language in between. Google officially released its Android for Work tool to businesses through the Google Play Store this week. The app, in conjunction with Google's Android for Work partners, gives IT more control over Android devices while providing end users more protection for their personal data. Android for Work must be enabled and administered through a partner's enterprise mobility management solution, and launch partners include AirWatch, BlackBerry, Citrix, Google Apps for Work, Mass 360 or IBM, Mobile Iron, SAP, and Sauti. It handles productivity and business apps while segregating work from personal data in a way that makes sense for companies and their employees. Now, to illustrate why Android is still a problem in the enterprise, Android for Work is aimed solely at devices running Android versions 4.4 KitKat and lower. It doesn't support Android 5.0 Lollipop. Still, it's definitely a step in the right direction.
While thieves have a new tool that can unlock your car in seconds, time to keep your keys in the freezer. The gist is that thieves seem to be using a new class of RF amplifier that tricks your car into thinking your key fob is a whole lot closer than you thought. Their article talks about how some kids pulled out one of these boxes as he watched in horror as his car opened up for them. So the bottom line on this new hack is if you have a car that auto unlocks when you get close, like a Prius, you may want to keep your key fobs in a foil bag or the freezer since the amplifier can't amplify what isn't there.
Sting you, sting me, sting Ray together. That's the way it should be. In California, a state senator is pushing for Senate Bill 741, which would require city and county governments to get public approval for the acquisition and use of cellular communication interception technologies. The bill passed its first committee on Wednesday by a vote of 7-0 and complements SB 178, which would require, surprise, a warrant, not a vague court order for such a device. It's an interesting first step, though it's not certain that state laws would trump the FBI's recently disclosed powers to demand the dropping of public scrutiny in cases involving stingrays.
Skype for Business is really here. Microsoft announced the general availability of its new Skype for Business client, released as part of the April monthly update for Office 2013. Skype for Business Online is also rolling out to global Office 365 customers, an automatic process that's expected to be completed by the end of May. The new business platform is based on Skype, which more than 300 million people currently use to communicate. The business iteration allows customers to search for and connect with anyone on their Skype network, whether they're inside or outside the organization. Skype for Business is built into Office, so features like IM, voice and video calls, presence and online meetings are now all integrated Office components. New platform will also add to the features currently available on Link. The upshot? Well, it's getting harder and harder to tell the world that they just can't reach you on the phone.
Well, here we go. Oregon goes fishing for Google Fiber with new tax rules. You go there, Oregon. It seems Oregon's Governor Kate Brown is enacting an exception to Oregon's sticky property tax rules to address Google's objections to rolling out the fiber service in Portland and five additional municipalities. Seems the rules originally were created for microwave towers, and it had a rule about intangible value of assets like brand names. Huh. Nice. And good advice to other states where laws is seen as set in stone rather than something that should be reviewed for applicability once in a blue moon.
You know nothing, Jon Snow, about BYOD. Aruba Networks, recently acquired by HP, has released a report on securing BYOD devices that comes to a relatively simple conclusion. We don't know how. Over the past 5 years, 82% of surveyed organizations have adopted the use of consumer devices in the workplace, but the users of those consumer devices have not adopted proper data security practices. Among the highlights, 60% of workers share their BYOD-connected work and personal devices with people not in the company. 20% don't have passwords on their devices, and 87% assume that IT is keeping them protected no matter what they actually do with their devices. Even more troubling, 20% of companies surveyed don't actually have a written BYOD policy. Winter is coming wirelessly. Well, folks, when we come back, we're going to jump into the Enterprise Bites. But before that, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, interesting fact, we spend about one-third of our lives sleeping. But the sad thing is that most of us don't consider sleep, good sleep, refreshing sleep, as mission critical. Everybody knows the effect of a bad night's sleep, tossing and turning, waking up multiple times in the middle of the night, all to get up and face a day without a full tank of rest. Now, we're finding out more and more just how critical that good rest is. You don't make good decisions, you don't have good work productivity, and you just don't enjoy life if you don't get a full night's sleep, which is why we're happy to have Casper as part of the Twilight Riot. Now, Casper is an online retailer of premium mattresses that offer high-quality sleep for a fraction of the cost of the other guys. They do this by cutting the cost of dealing with resellers and showrooms. Rather than paying those middlemen, they sell to you directly and at a price that you deserve to pay. Okay, enough of the pocket pitch. What makes Casper worth a third of your life? Well, they've combined latex and memory foam so that you have a bed that has just the right sink and bounce. They're soft and comfortable, but firm enough to prevent you from falling into your bed. Casper mattresses provide long-lasting comfort and support with a 100-day return period so that you can try it out and see for yourself if it's right for you. I mean, you can have it ordered online, you can have it delivered, and you can feel what it's like to sleep on a Casper bed for more than 3 months before actually deciding if it's right for you. That's impossible to do in a showroom where you get, what, maybe 30 to 90 seconds of lying on a demo before deciding. Now, here's what we want you to do. We want you to stop settling for bad sleep. Get yourself a risk-free Casper mattress today. $500 for a twin or $950 for a king size. That's compared to an industry average that becomes an outstanding price. And you can save an additional $50 as one of our audience members by going to casper.com/twiet and entering the promo code twiet. That's casper.com/twiet and the promo code twiet. A good night, done right, with Casper. And we thank Casper for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Well, gentlemen, let's go ahead and jump straight into our Enterprise Bites. This first one is, well, I find it a little sad. AMD has announced that they're getting out of the Microserver game. Now, just under 3 years after promising epic power and resource savings with a vast array of microservers using ARM-based processors, AMD is exiting the market. They purchased SeaMicro in 2012 for $334 million. Now, SeaMicro made Intel Atom and Xeon-based systems that use share storage and network fabric. Ultimately, they've released nothing but vapor about AMD's ARM-based A1100, which was supposed to give us just remarkable power savings. Now, they'll take a $75 million special charge, but they'll keep SeaMicro's IPs. Essentially, this means that SeaMicro is defunct. However, I think there's a bigger story here than just one manufacturer getting out of the game. As recently as last year, in fact, I remember reading an article in May of last year, microservers were touted as the future of the data center. The idea was that rather than having a rack of high-powered servers that could do a lot of things, you would have an immensely dense rack of microservers that were good at doing one or two things very well, and you would spin them up and down as necessary. Now, it was a very good idea in theory, but we haven't really seen that idea materialize. Chibert, I want to throw this over to you first. Why haven't we seen the rise of microservers? It was promised to us that they were going to become one of 10 server purchases by 2016, and now it looks like everyone's getting out of the game.
Well, the whole trick is virtualization's gotten a whole heck of a lot cheaper, a lot easier to do. You can thin provision servers like you wouldn't believe, and especially if you're using Linux, it's not hard at all. And the support for Linux in the virtualization world is great. And it also doesn't fit the HPC model because high-performance computing requires a lot of floating point and so forth, where you need the high density, but you also need the computing power. So the shoe doesn't fit. So it was one of these products that was looking for a solution, and the solution never really materialized because the virtualization world has gotten a lot better.
Actually, that's a very good point. 5 years ago, when servers were still relatively expensive and virtualization didn't really have a worked out way to license it cheaply, it looked like physical hardware, microservers, was going to be a big thing. In fact, we call it system on a chip. So let me ask you, Curtis, is system on a chip dead, or did they just overpromise with microservers and system on a chip still has a future?
Well, I think system on a chip probably has a future, but in much more targeted applications. I think there will be places where you see it, but in terms of broad applicability across the enterprise, you know, it's just one of those things where mainstream servers have gotten so much more efficient and so much better, and virtualization has become so much better, so much less expensive, and so much more a known quantity that the argument for going in this new direction is just not nearly as compelling as it was a few years ago. System on a chip, still going to exist, but you're going to need to target it at very specific use cases and not something that's going to sell in the hundreds of millions of quantities.
Actually, very good point. Chibert, I do want to throw something back at you. Is Is this microserver, this idea of a system on a chip, a lot of them in a very dense rack, is it actually just an idea that missed its window by a decade or so? Because what I've seen is the rise of containerized applications, and that's basically taking the place of a system on a chip. It's taking the place of a microserver. And so it now doesn't seem to be very cost-effective to get individual pieces of hardware where you could just have individual containerized applications.
Well, system on a chip and these microservers, I think they went for the wrong market. The reality is there's an amazing number of new embedded devices coming out, small appliances. People are wanting more than just a NAS in a small office. They want to be able to go and run various other pieces. Just look at what Synology and QNAP and Cisco and all these people are doing with those baby NASs that can run all these interesting applications like Asterisk, Git, Apache, and so forth. But they're overwhelmed. You throw too many apps on even a good-sized Synology, and suddenly you start flogging a very slow tortoise. But if you threw a few microservers in there, make them like little blades so you can throw additional horsepower in, that's a market I think microservers would work really well in. Unfortunately, the data center isn't it because virtualization is dirt cheap now.
Yeah, actually very much so. Curtis, last question to you on this story. We have seen some advances, as Chiebert mentioned, from companies like Synology or the partner IOSafe, where you can now run Docker, which is that containerized application that everybody seems to love all of a sudden, on very low-powered, low-cost devices. And you can get 90% of what you would with a far more expensive microserver rack with a commoditized NAS that can also do Docker applications. Are you with Chiebert? Does system on a chip, does microservers still have a market? It's just far more specialized than they thought it was going to be?
Oh, absolutely. And, with Brian, I'll go with Internet of Things. You know, one of the issues that people were talking about at the Gartner conference last year, or the Gartner symposium, is the fact that with the Internet of Things, with all of these sensors, all of these small devices out there, enterprise servers and enterprise networks could be flooded with just thousands upon thousands upon thousands of new connections, new devices. Well, what if out in these remote areas you had a dedicated system on a chip microserver to gather the data from the sensors and controllers in a particular location, combine them, do some basic analysis, and then ship that information back to the enterprise servers? You've done rationalization. You've minimized the amount of information that has to be transmitted over the network, and you're still getting the effect. So I feel that we're probably going to see these still used out in the field, out in remote locations, as I said, in niche applications where the return is very specialized, very knowable, and just not in the general purpose world of the data center.
So there's still a future for these devices that were supposed to be the future of the data center, just not in the data center. Let's go ahead and move on to the second story we've got here. And this is actually a continuation of that same discussion. And Chiebert, I'm going to throw this at you first. Have containers made virtual machines obsolete? Now, a year ago, it was all about the virtual machine. That's what we were talking about. We were getting VMware onto the show. We were talking about virtual desktop infrastructure in relation to virtual machines and all the things that it could do, all the efficiencies that it could bring into the enterprise. Now, that still has a place. But again, in this last year, we have seen the absolute boom of this idea of a containerized app. And it's not just Docker. Microsoft's got a version. Amazon's got a version. IBM's got a version. Everyone's got something that can run on bare metal, that can run very efficiently and can run very cleanly, but doesn't carry all the overhead of a virtual machine. Now, let's talk first about the key differences between what a container is and a virtual machine, because a lot of people will equate the two, and they're not really the same. A VM, a virtual machine, allows you to run multiple OSs on a single machine. You get to boot into different OSs, and each of those OSs, for example, at Interop, when we run our various servers, allows us to bring up new services and turn them on and off as necessary. A container is different. It's not going to contain a full OS. It's going to run on top of an OS. It's stripped down just to offer the functionality of the application that it's supposed to offer, which makes it a much more lightweight package, which is why I can run a container, a Docker, on my Synology NAS rather than having to run a VM on my server cluster. Achievert, let me ask for your view on this. As you have seen the rise of the container over the last year, and it's not a new technology, it's just a technology that's, I think, has finally arrived. Have you seen pressure against VMs? Is it pushing VMs off?
Well, okay. The concept of a container, it's potato, potato. It's been there. It's been developing over the years. It's not that far away from what people really wanted out of virtual machines. They don't care about the VM operating system. They don't care about all the bells and whistles. They want to be able to go and do their tasks that they need to get done. They want to concentrate on work. In my case, I want to concentrate on science. There's lots of times when people need to go be able to go and run applications that are not native to their operating system, but they really didn't want to have to go and put a full operating system under there. They didn't want to have to go and manage a virtual machine. They wanted the promise of the so-called Type 2 hypervisor, where it was a virtualization system that ran on top of a host operating system, but they wanted the speed of a Type 1, where it was bare metal. A container is halfway in between because you are bare metal to an extent. It has less of the baggage of a virtualization system. And in theory, you know, depending on how well it's implemented, it lets you get down to doing business. And yes, because of the way it's done, you now have the ability to have one container that in theory will run on lots and lots of different platforms, which is perfect for like a baby NAS market where you want to maintain the ultra low power or the Internet of Things. So it's just like in the old days when we used to have Ethernet cards for every, you know, the different version of Mozilla, or actually a web browser for every single NIC card out there. Containers could potentially have the same impact because it's creating a layer of abstraction so that you can run different things and not have to worry quite so much about the hardware underneath. You know, get down to business.
Curtis, I'm going to throw you the same question I threw to Chievert, because he gave us a lot of information, but I still have that question of, are VMs getting pushed out? I think one of the key things that Chievert brought up was that containers, again, it's technology that's been around for a while, but containers are actually doing what people wanted out of VMs. People didn't want to have to care about how the application was running. They just wanted the application running. They wanted it to be gathering data. And this idea that I could have one container that can run on my local NAS before being pushed up to Amazon service, before pushed over to Azure, it's very compelling. In what you've seen at Information Week Radio, have the discussion of containers taken over from the discussion about virtualization?
You know, the discussion about containers really has become huge. At Information Week, we have one editor, Charlie Babcock, who's covering these in great depth and in great detail. We're seeing a lot of interest in those articles because, you know, as Brian said, people care deeply about getting an application. People care deeply about getting a function from their software. By and large, unless you're a developer, or unless you are somehow tasked with administering licenses, you don't care what the operating system is, and you don't want to care. You know, in many ways, this is a gift of cloud. People got used to the idea that through cloud services, they could simply get the software, they could simply get the function, and they didn't have to worry about which operating system they were using. Now, with the containers, they can carry that into their own data center, into their own hosted facilities, and still not have to care, by and large, about the operating system. It's all about the application. It's all about the service. That means inevitably that machines, whether virtual or real, are a commodity, and a commodity that no one really cares about.
Right. Chievert, that's actually a very interesting point of view. And combined with Hodor in the chat room, who's, you know, he wanted to know if containers could be agnostic. This idea that I can have everything I expected out of my VM, or everything I really wanted out of my VM, the whole self-contained unit, and I can run it on any system, mostly any system, makes it incredibly attractive. As a system administrator yourself, what would you rather have to do? Spin up a high-cost rack of VM servers, or have a series of containers that you can run locally in the cloud or in a hybrid of the two?
Actually, you know, all of the above. And gee, wouldn't it be really, really cool if I could just carry my container around on a big, fast flash drive, move around and have my environment go with me? I'm not sure everybody wants this big, massive virtualization system. You know, VVI is a great technology. I think containers have an amazing future in the VDI world, because then you just move it around, just plug it in. And what about things like the promise of an agnostic cell phone, an agnostic smartphone? Wouldn't it be really great if all the developers just wrote for a container and then run containers on a smartphone? That's pretty cool.
Very cool indeed. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for the Enterprise Bite. We will be right back. We'll be bringing in Vijay Balasubramaniyan. He's the CEO and founder of Pindrop Security. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. And of course, it's got to be ZipRecruiter. Now, let me ask you something. Are you hiring? I mean, hiring right now. Are you looking to find the right person with the right talent fast? I mean, we all are. That's what hiring is all about. And really, hiring hasn't changed a whole lot since I did it way back when. You find the right person with the right skills, you interview them, you make sure that they can do the job, and then you regret hiring them half the time. And the reason why you can regret hiring them half the time is because if you don't look at a large enough applicant pool, then you don't get the person with the right culture. Because it's not just about skill set, it's about how they're going to fit into the company. So you do need to cast as wide a net as possible. That's why we're proud to have ZipRecruiter as part of the Twiet Riot. They help you cast that wide net. A ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place isn't enough to find quality candidates. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites. And that's what ZipRecruiter does for you. With ZipRecruiter.com, you post your job once and it gets placed on 50 plus job sites, including Craigslist, LinkedIn, and Twitter, all with a single click. ZipRecruiter will help you find candidates in any city or industry nationwide. Just post once and watch your qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. And now ZipRecruiter offers Traffic Boost, which can get you up to 3 times as many qualified candidates for your job opening. There will be no juggling of emails or calls to your office. Instead, you'll just quickly screen candidates, rate them, and hire the right person fast. Find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 200,000 businesses. Right now, our listeners can try ZipRecruiter for free. That's right, for free. For a free 4-day trial, go to ZipRecruiter.com/Twiet. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twiet. Hire the right person fast now with ZipRecruiter. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. We welcome to the show a man who we've been trying to get on for quite a while, but his schedule is absolutely crazy busy, Vijay Balasubraman. Vijay, bear with me. Balasubramaniyan from Pindrop. Was that close?
Oh, no, I was very close.
I've had so much practice, and I just can't get it. Sir, it's great to have you. You are the CEO and founder of Pindrop Security. I met you first, actually, both Chibert and I, at DEF CON 2014, where you were talking about this idea of protecting your enterprise, not just with network, not just with physical security, but through your phone system. Very quickly, can you explain to me what is the mission statement of Pindrop?
So the mission statement of Pindrop is, as you know, folks are quickly moving to seeing voice as the new interface, we want to be the layer of security, trust, and identity for every single voice interaction and every voice device.
Yeah, that's actually quite simple. What we have here is we have a interview that we did with both you and your chief data scientist at DEF CON. And I think you did a very good job of explaining why people will want Pindrop. To Vijay and Raj, I'm not even going to attempt to say their names. Vijay, what's your last name?
Vijay Balasubramaniyan.
And Raj?
Raj Bandopadhyay.
Much better than I would ever be able to say it. security experts with Pindrop Security. Now, you are going to tell me about a different kind of exploit that we're used to seeing. Here at the conference, we're typically focused on network security, physical security. There's something else. There's phone security. Tell me why I should be worried.
Yeah, so as you can imagine, there's a lot of companies have invested a lot of money in network and online security. But what's happened with that is fraudsters have been quickly pushed to what's the weakest link, which is the phone channel by which you call a particular bank, a particular telco, or a particular state benefit program. And so as a result of this, phone fraud is significantly on the rise, so much so that banks right now, which suffer about $4 billion in fraud, are estimating anywhere between 30 to 80% of all that fraud is actually coming on the phone channel. So it's a pretty massive amount of fraud all funneling through that one phone channel.
Oh, Raj, what do you mean by phone fraud? I mean, how does someone take advantage of this weakest link in order to get information from you that they shouldn't have?
There are a couple of ways to do this, but the most common one, think of what happens when you call into your bank using their customer service number. You call in and they ask you a few questions like, you know, what's your mother's maiden name, what's your social security number, and so on. If someone calls in, claims to be you, and they somehow have acquired that private information about you, then they can practically get your account and take all your money. And banks actually allow you to withdraw a lot more money on the phone than online.
Right. So some of the more prominent users are essentially, you know, calling into the organization and essentially wiring money out or ordering new plastic, right? I'm traveling, I need new plastic to North Carolina, or I'm ordering new checks, or I'm increasing my credit limit. So there's a wide variety of ways in which you can monetize these accounts. On the retailer side, you've ordered a new camera. I can always claim that camera never reached my house. I want it to go to a different address. That's called replacement order scam. So there's, each organization has its own vulnerabilities as far as their call center is concerned, and there's a way to monetize a particular account to financial profit.
Now, Raj, when this has happened in the enterprises that I've been a part of, typically we just say, well, they found the stupid person in my organization. We found a person who wasn't that bright or wasn't paying attention. You're saying that maybe we could solve the problem earlier in the chain before the call even gets to the individual.
That is correct. One thing that we have found is that fraudsters, even before they make that actual phone call to steal money to a call center agent, they are doing a lot of reconnaissance to collect information. And in particular, they're using the IVR, that is the interactive voice response, which is the automated menus that banks have, like, you know, press one for this, press two for that. They use that very liberally to mine for information. So they'll try out different account numbers that they might have in a list or something that they've gotten off a black market and see if, you know, which are the valid account numbers for this bank, or they'll find, you know, try out different social security numbers. And once you have hit a valid account number, automatically the system lets you into the next step and say, welcome, Mr. So-and-so, your balance is XYZ. So they already have two more pieces of information about you. So they can take all that information that they gather and then actually hit the call center to talk to an agent to actually make the transfer.
Now that we know what the problem is, that they're using our automated tray against us, what are some of the ways to mitigate that issue?
Right. So the fact that they're using the automated tray actually reveals as much about the bank as the fraudster itself. So the fact that they're going through serially one after the other, predicting social security numbers or account numbers, if you have devices that are constantly looking at this reconnaissance activity, you can identify which of the social security numbers the fraudsters have. So in this cat and mouse game, you're reversing the roles. You're actually seeing what the fraudster is doing, and you can forewarn the organization that something bad is going to happen to an account. And in our particular case, we were able to forewarn organizations 16 days before the account ever got compromised about an impending attack.
Raj, I want to talk a little bit about this forecasting, because when I read the Pindrop Security press release for Black Hat, that was the part that sort of caught my attention. The fact that you pay attention to what's happening around the world and you can forecast when you think a campaign, a wave of fraudulent calls is going to happen. How does that work?
So basically, we look at a lot of the metadata around phone calls. So when organizations get phone calls, they collect not just the phone number, but also they keep track of timestamps, the call duration, but also what the the caller is actually doing in the call. Like, what are they doing in those automated menus, the steps, and so on. So we look at three kinds of features there. One are what we call reputation features. What that means is that, what do we know about this phone number? So in many cases, there are phone numbers that look like legitimate phone numbers, but are actually invalid numbers, for example, because that number block has never been allocated to a carrier. A call center agent or a user, like a general regular person, would not know that. But we keep track of that, and we can flag that. There are other features like the carrier and the type of device and so on that form the reputation. The other thing we look at is called what we call velocity, which is, what is that phone number doing across time? Is it making, you know, like calls to thousands of numbers a day, something like that? Or is it like making calls at some very periodic frequency, which would indicate an automated caller or something? So that's what we call velocity. Those are another very important set of indicators. And the third set of indicators are what we call behavior, which is, what is this number, this caller doing in one particular call or in a group of like very, you know, close calls in time? What are they doing? And that's where we find the exact patterns of traversing through those automated menus. You'll find that the way fraudulent callers who are mining for information traverse those automated menus can be very different from the ways legitimate users might use a system. So those are some features we look at. We can put them together and create a model that can predict for a given call, when a call comes in, like how likely is it to be a reconnaissance call.
One last bit that I got from the press release that, again, caught the mind of my audience was this idea of acoustic signatures, the ability to actually dig deeper into a call and determine whether or not it's fraudulent. How does that work?
Right. So we look at a whole bunch of acoustical artifacts. So a call is almost like a river meandering through. Everywhere it goes, it collects sediments off that place. So, you know, when you finally look at the river and you see red clay, you say it's gone through a place that's, you know, had red clay. And so the audio is very similar to that. When it goes over an IP network, it undergoes packet loss. And that packet loss manifests itself as small, tiny breaks in the call audio, which is something you and I can't hear, but it's there. So what our system looks for is artifacts like that, noise artifacts, frequency artifacts, and even loss artifacts. And by virtue of looking at all of these things, you can actually reconstruct where the call started from, what device was used making that call, and where did the call go. So if a call started from a Skype phone in Nigeria, went to UK, and then came to the US, you can actually determine all of that by just listening to the call audio. And if that person is saying, I'm actually a customer calling from Atlanta, you know he's lying. And immediately you can identify that most likely an account takeover is happening. And we are able to identify over 80% of all account takeover attempts at organizations just by this.
Vijay Raj, I want to thank you very much for talking to us, for giving this information to our audience. If they wanted to find more about Pindrop Security and about your solutions, where should they go?
It's simple. It's www.pindropsecurity.com.
When I saw this at DEF CON, I was absolutely blown away, because it's kind of like the complete cycle. Vijay, we started hacking. Malicious people started hacking networks because it became an easier way to obtain information. Network security has gotten to the point where it's no longer the lowest hanging fruit. And I think the lowest hanging fruit is now your automated calling tree. And that's really what Pindrop is trying to address, right?
Absolutely. It's both the call tree as well as the fact that you have call center agents on the other end providing financial transaction advice to a caller. So it's both being able to use your call tree against you, as well as social engineering your call center agents to essentially take over an account.
Right, because unfortunately, there's no way to really protect your call center people. I mean, if your call center people's gonna, if they're gonna fall for a scam, they're gonna fall for a scam. You can train them as much as you want, you can give them as much warning, and yet if they don't catch the cues, if they don't listen quite right enough, they're gonna fail. And that could be, again, your lowest hanging fruit. That's the easiest point of entry into your network. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to bring in my co-hosts here, and let's have a discussion about exactly how Pindrop works, exactly who you're trying to serve, because there's some very interesting data there. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the last sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. and it's Dropbox for Business. Now, if you've ever looked at an easy way to share and sync files, then you've used Dropbox. It's right up there. It's the one that people trust. It's the one that people already use. In fact, our audience, I would say it's upwards of 90%+ of us have some form of Dropbox account. It's just such an easy way to send files to people that you need to have a look at some data. It's also a very good way to sync things back and forth between your devices. But as ubiquitous as Dropbox has become, I'm betting that there's a lot of those 90% who don't realize that there's actually a Dropbox specifically designed for business. Dropbox for Business is the better way to manage accounts, manage billing, and most importantly, for those of us who have to keep an eye on how data travels in our enterprises, have visibility and control over that data. Dropbox for Business lets you do just that. So what is Dropbox for Business, you might be asking yourself? Well, it's the same easy-to-use, quick-to-set-up Dropbox that your users and employees already love and trust. That's important because it means that you don't have to train them in a new solution. They already use it. It provides simple storage and sharing for any type of file on any platform and any device. If you're worried about space, well, just don't. Each Dropbox for Business user starts off with a terabyte, and it's easy to expand. Staff can collaborate with team members and securely invite and control access to outside partners, clients, and vendors. And most importantly for IT professionals, Dropbox for Business has powerful admin controls like the ability to remote wipe, intuitively sharing and permissive controls, plus complete audit logs. This way, IT can make sure that only the right people get access to sensitive company data. Dropbox for Business integrates with third-party security and administrative tools such as SIEM, DLP, and eDiscovery for even more control. And last but not least, the robust Dropbox for Business infrastructure uses encryption for file data in transit and at rest, plus segmentation and hashing to anonymize files. Extra security features are available like single sign-on and two-step verification. You already use Dropbox, as does 4 million businesses. So why look for another solution when you've already got the one that works? If you want to give it a try, if you want to take advantage of your employees' familiarity with Dropbox and sign up for Dropbox for Business, well, here's where you can do it. Visit dropbox.com/business for a free 14-day trial of Dropbox for Business. That's dropbox.com/business. And we thank Dropbox for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Getting back to the action, we are speaking with Vijay Balasubramaniyan of Pindrop Security. He's their CEO and founder. And I want to bring in my co-host, Cheebert and Curtis. Cheebert, you were with me at DEF CON. Curtis, I know you've heard about this company. You've heard about the technology. What do you think about protecting your call center, about protecting your automated tree, about protecting the employees who actually have to interact with the outside world? Cheebert, let's start with you.
Well, I just bring up the fact that your call centers, your people, they all cost money. You know, even if it's only a couple seconds to hang up on someone, it all adds up. So, wow, this makes all kinds of sense. And, you know, I kind of wish, you know, we had that at the university, but we'll never get it because university doesn't believe in this kind of stuff.
Curtis,
but I could really see it as a great feature for a lot of companies.
Right. Curtis, let me ask you again, dealing with your exclusive connections with executives at Information Week Radio, has this been a topic of concern? I mean, so much of what we do is focused on the network. Previously, we had been obsessed with firewalls. Now we're obsessed with zoning and proper security within a network. But you don't ever hear a lot of talk about protecting the phone system.
Well, that's true. But it's important to note, one of the discussions we've had here over and over and over again is about the economic impact of hacking versus the economic cost of protection. There probably is not any segment of a business that has been more carefully financially scrutinized than call centers. Companies that have call centers know to the penny how much each second of those call center operators' time is worth. And therefore, this is the one area of an enterprise where it's very easy to see the cost versus the benefit of greater security. And I think the real impact that this can have is that this is the perfect opportunity to start out with a firm economic analysis that can then ultimately be spread to the rest of the organization. So if you want to really have better security throughout the organization, the call centers and the telephone systems they use are the perfect place to start.
Vijay, what about that? That's an interesting point. The fact that call centers are so financially scrutinized. You know exactly how much it's costing you per minute, per customer that you're dealing with. Is that something that Pindrop uses in its pitch when you talk to these companies with call centers and say, look, you've already invested X amount of money. Don't you want to protect that investment?
Absolutely. I think there are three core value propositions to Pindrop. The first is the amount of fraud dollars that we save going out from these organizations. And as the industry as a whole is trending towards the fact that they're losing close to about $10 billion by fraud coming on the phone channel. So it's a pretty massive amount that they're losing just in terms of fraud. The second value proposition is the amount of time you can reduce for a call center agent who's asking all these questions. The only form of security that these call centers have when they're trying to identify you is, you know, what's your mother's maiden name, what's your date of birth, and things like that. And these fraudsters are really, really good. You know, one of my favorite calls is this fraudster calls in, and when the call center agent asks him, what's your mother's maiden name, he says, my dad married thrice, so can I take three guesses? And the call center agent allows him to take those three guesses. And, you know, he finally wires out $90,000 to a bank in Cambodia. But the fundamental thing is they're spending all that time trying to find out who you are using these set of questions which the fraudsters know the answers to, or social engineer their way out of it. And so organizations on average are spending about 60 to 90 seconds asking you these questions each second, just to the point that that you made, spends about 2.5 cents per second. So if you calculate that as a whole, in the US alone, they spend about $10.6 billion asking people these stupid questions. So absolutely, we can reduce the amount of time. The UK spends just as much in asking people questions, and that's very much a value proposition for Pindrop.
That is a staggering amount of money, both spent to defend and lost through that kind of a fraud. I know you can't get too specific because, of course, these are your clients. They're, you know, it's sensitive information. But let me ask you this. You could go to a call center and say, best practices here, if you want to defend against this fraud, is to use multi-factor authentication. But no call center would do that because now you're inconveniencing the customer. And you can't do that because then you start to lose business rather than losing it to fraud. So Pindrop is in a unique position here. You've got that 16-day forecasting where you can actually look at trends. You can look where the traffic is going. And you can look at where people are focusing their fraud attempts. And then you can warn your clients about it. So is that how you're doing it now? Are you telling your clients, we understand that you can't change the way that you verify, but we can at least tell you when you're being attacked?
Right. That's one part of what we do, right? The fact that we can almost predict beforehand which accounts are going to be targeted. And this comes especially in handy when you have these big data breaches. So when Home Depot or Target or Anthem, whenever you had any of these data breaches, the fraudsters get small pieces of information. They get, for example, the name and address and the email address. And then they use that to figure out the social security number. And then they start mining the call tree to determine all other pieces of information. Now that I have social security numbers, which banks does this person bank with? Which retailers does he buy his products from? And they do all of that and essentially compile an identity. And then they take the identity out to the cleaners, right? Then they steal money from that identity. But the fact that we can see that activity in the IVR, and in fact, we see a massive spike in activity after every data breach because they're then trying to compile that identity. So that's absolutely one thing that we do, which is we forewarn customers of accounts that are, that have been caught in these data breaches or have been identified by these fraudsters to go after. The second thing that we do is we also identify these fraudsters when they actually come in to the call center trying to steal money, right? That's another portion. And it's a combination of these two things, right? The fact that we can forewarn them for certain accounts, that there is reconnaissance activity happening on those accounts. And even if there is no reconnaissance activity and the fraudster has compiled the entire identity through some other means and comes into the call center trying to social engineer a call center agent, we can identify them even then.
All right. Vijay, I do want to give you a couple of questions that we're getting from the people in the chat room live right now. We've got a very smart audience. Cool Breeze has just looked up your website after watching that video, and he is kind of blown away by the whole acoustic signature technology that you have. We glossed over it very quickly in the video, but in a nutshell, what you can do is you can listen to certain audio clues that we wouldn't, as humans, we just wouldn't listen to, that will tell you if something is VoIP, if you hear packets being switched off, between networks. Like, for example, when the system detects that they've got a live person and now they can attempt to defraud them. That's something that's unique to Pindrop, right? Can you tell us a little bit more about how that system works?
Absolutely. So, in fact, that entire... All these features together are called what are known as phone printing, and we're the only ones with patents for it. So we've built patents around this entire concept of phone printing. And we talked about one example, right? Call goes over a voice over IP network. We're doing this entire podcast on a voice over IP system, Skype. So there is going to be packet losses, and those packet losses manifest themselves as tiny breaks in the call audio. So that's one example of a feature. Another example of a feature is, as a lot of networks moved from analog to digital, what happened is in analog systems, you had ambient noise in the system. So when you were talking to someone over the phone, even if they were not speaking, you'd hear a faint kind of sound, which allowed you to know that that person on the other end, was still on the call. When you went completely digital, what would happen is that would get replaced but with pure silence. So you'd think the person on the other end hung up. And so what these devices started doing is introducing comfort noise just to make you comfortable that there's someone on the other end. And that comfort noise is algorithmically generated as opposed to being random. And that has a pattern. So the way your iPhone introduces comfort noise as opposed to the way a Android phone introduces comfort noise as opposed to the way BlackBerry introduces comfort noise is very, very different. That becomes another signature. So there are a variety of such signatures that are present within the call. We look at 147 such artifacts to build out the complete signature and are therefore able to identify the device, what geography is that call coming from, and what type of device is behind that particular call.
Wait, let's back up just a second there, because you said something that just absolutely amazed me. Depending on what type of voice of device you're using, iPhone, Android, Windows Phone, BlackBerry, how it introduces that noise, you can actually audio print what device people are using?
Absolutely. And that's the thing, right? One of the things that we detect very often is, here's this person who's calling from a phone number. It's a AT&T cell phone in Atlanta, but the audio characteristics tell us it's actually a Skype laptop calling in from Nigeria. So something is very, very wrong with that call. It's most likely that fraudster is spoofing that phone number and trying to take over the account.
Wow, that's actually amazing. I really want to see that go. Cheebert, I did not know that. I had no idea that you could actually catalog what devices are calling your network just by listening to that silence. Have you seen this tech at all before?
No, not really. No, but the comfort noise has been around for a very long time. When we did a voice over IP shootout for InfoWorld, God, maybe a decade ago, that's one of the things that they brought up during the briefings is digital calls are too silent and comfort right. noise has to be introduced. And what Vijay is saying is absolutely true. It's just a matter of how you analyze it and pull those signatures out. And it sounds like Pindrop's really done a good job on that.
Curtis, let me throw this over to you really quickly, because what we're hearing about the ability to phone print certain calls and the ability to find out when automated systems are being used, because that could be a precursor to fraud. This all sounds like something that every enterprise that implements a call center needs to do, and yet I don't think they do. What would be your take if you were trying to speak to a CTO or CEO, a CFO, and explain why they need to include this along with the bill of materials for any new call center, how would you try to explain it to them?
Well, I think the big way you explain it is to go back to the words of a recent government official who told the world, you know what, you're going to have to deal with attackers. You just have to assume that they're going to be there. And with that, you have to look at ways to know when they have hit your border and sometimes even know when they've made it through. This is a valuable tool in that direction. I mean, it's not a question of whether people are going to use any given method, any given attack vector to try to reach you. They are. And so in the same way that we now accept the need for firewalls, we accept the need for IPS, IDS, we accept the need for all kinds of things, it's time to add this to the list of things that we simply accept as a necessary part of the cost of doing business. Why do we do that? Because, to be brutally honest, the cost of failure is just so darned high.
All right. Vijay, I want to go back to you. One of the things that we've seen in cybersecurity is this cat and mouse game, that the attackers will try something, will come up with a counter to the attack, and then they'll change their methods. Are you seeing this on the phone side, or is there such a large target area that they just simply move to the easier call centers to crack?
Right. We're seeing both of that. So, you know, one of the earliest gangs we started profiling, so we have a massive database of well-known phone fraudster devices, right? And so one of the earlier gangs that we identified was a gang we affectionately call West Africa One. and they have, you know, a bunch of fraudsters. In fact, if you look at Pindrop, a lot of our conference rooms are named after these fraudsters. So there's McGruff, there's Chicken Man, there's Dava, there's Chipmunk and things like that. So this West Africa One group was originally, you know, just coming right out of West Africa, right? They were coming out of Nigeria and places like that. And what happened is they started getting detected. So what they started doing in order to seem more legitimate is they started hacking PBXs in UK and started routing their calls through that. But the very interesting thing about audio is the more you add, you start doing all these different routing, it isn't as the crow flies, you're actually adding newer and newer artifacts. Mm. So this is very different than what a legitimate customer is doing. He's just using the standard route and making a call to your call center, whereas these guys are trying to obfuscate themselves by going through a variety of hops. And as soon as you do that with something that's as real-time as audio, it will degrade its quality. It will start affecting the audio characteristics in very, very subtle ways. And that's exactly what we need, right? So the more they struggle, it's almost like quicksand. The more they struggle, the more they sink themselves. And this is exactly one of the reasons why we're able to identify them really, really well.
So in essence, what they're trying to do is they're trying to avoid detection the old school way, how you would do it if you were just routing IP data, which is you compromise more systems so you can make more hops and get away from the origin more effectively. What you're saying is, as you do that, as you obfuscate the network route, you actually make it easier to identify acoustical anomalies.
Yep. As you obfuscate the network route, you open up the audio route. You clearly show what the audio route is.
So there's, I mean, of course, you can't tell me because then they'd start using it. But this sounds like an incredibly effective way to identify these sorts of attacks, because you really can't get around it. I mean, the more you try to get away from letting people actually locate where you are, the easier it will be for you to detect that, oh, yeah, this is probably a scam attempt.
Absolutely. And that's the thing, right? Wow. Until they actually physically relocate themselves to every fraud customer that they're trying to impersonate. So they're trying to impersonate you, they relocate to your area, get your kind of device, get your service provider, and do that for every single customer account that they're trying to target, because, you know, as soon as it's different from the typical customer account, you can immediately see the anomalies. If they do that, that's the only way they'll beat the system. But fraudsters believe in economies of scale, right? Fraud as a service is a very real thing. So they want to do something, do things at scale. And by virtue of doing that, they reveal themselves. And so that's one of our most effective ways in identifying them. And this is why what we find them doing is as soon as they find that it's just that hard to steal an account, somehow this system is detecting them each time. And it's doing that behind the scenes without them knowing what we're really doing. What they do is move on to the next organization.
Right.
And that works really, really well for us because, you know, as soon as we've deployed in one organization, bank number two or retailer number two gives us a call and says, we're suddenly seeing a spike in fraud in the voice channel. So it works well for us.
I kind of think of it as when someone tents a house for fumigation, all the vermin move to the house that's not tented. So essentially, anyone not under the Pindrop tent, they're coming for you.
Yep.
All right. One last question. And this is more fun. And this is coming out of the chat room again. This kind of technology could be applied at more than just the call center level. I mean, obviously, it works very well for a call center. But this ability to actually detect where calls are coming from and give you a degree of certainty that it's coming from where you think it's coming from, I could see it being used on the individual level. I mean, if a bank were to maintain the acoustic profiles that are often seen for a verified customer that knows, okay, this person normally calls from an iPhone or from home or from a PBX system. These are the acoustic signatures for those calls. This is what I should be hearing when that person is calling me. Now you get more of a whitelist rather than a blacklist. Is that something that Pindrop's looking at, or that's so far down the line that you don't even have to worry about it?
No, that's absolutely something we're looking at. So what we're doing is we're actually combining the phone print with your voice to say, is this Robert calling from his device, calling from his typical location? So the right person calling from the right phone, calling from the right location. And that allows a true multi-factor authentication mechanism, which totally eliminates the need for these questions, all these other ways in which they're trying to identify you. And you can start seeing how that can be used for things other than authentication, right? You want a more personalized customer experience. You can absolutely enable that once you clearly know who you're talking to on the other end. And it might be for an account, a customer that you already know about, or you can do it across organizations. So what if I've never banked with a particular bank, right? I've seen this person have interactions with other organizations, be it retailers, be it telcos, and now this is the first time he's presenting himself to me. Now that I have all this information already with him, I know exactly what his preferences are, and my conversation with him is going to be a purely customized one.
Vijay Balasubramaniyan, I want to thank you so very much for being on this episode of TWiET. We're going to have you back at some point. This is amazing technology. We've got plenty of comments pouring in from the chat room and from my internal chat room here with Brian, who's saying this would be great for the FBI. This would be great for 911 operations to be able to verify calls. Could you please tell the folks at home where they can find you, where they can find Pindrop, if they want to read more in depth about the services that you offer?
The way to go is www.pindropsecurity.com. We have a whole bunch of white papers. We have data sheets. We have a whole bunch of information. Even the original technical paper that I wrote back in 2010, which introduced the idea of phone printing, is available. So you can absolutely go there and request for information.
Vijay, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much. And we will see you next time.
Absolutely, Robert. Thank you.
Folks, that's it. You've spent another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 call center scamsters. I want to thank everyone for being here, especially my co-host, Cheebert. Let's start with you. Where can people find you, your work? What will you be working on for the next, oh, I don't know, say 10 days?
I will be in Lost Wages, Nevada, and I'm going to be working with Curtis and you and a bunch of other people on Interop. And I do want to go and put one plug in. One of the things they always do tell us about training for security systems is the people that are trying to scam you are patient. They collect grains of sand. You do this long enough and often enough, and pretty soon you have your whole beach.
Okay, speaking of life being a beach, we've also got Curtis Franklin. Actually, that was probably a really bad segue. Curtis, you will also be at Interop. We will also be together. Tell the folks where they can find you.
Well, as always, they can find me at Information Week Radio and Interop Radio. To get the URLs for all of that, just follow me on Twitter at KG4GWA or look for me over at Information Week, informationweek.com. And this time next week, sure enough, I'll be there in that beautiful city on the desert.
Absolutely. We're all going to see you for a special episode next week from Interop. At least two of us will be from Interop. And we're going to be bringing you coverage from the Interop show floor probably for the next 2 months or so. It's a fantastic show. If you get a chance, get over to Vegas. Come say hi to the three of us. We'll be hanging around near the NOC. I also want to thank you. That's right, our listener. The person who downloads this show each and every single week. If it weren't for you, we couldn't keep talking about the stuff that we love talking about. And so we want to do something for you. We want to give you a way to get all of our episodes automatically. All you have to do is go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet. Once you're there, you'll find all of our back episodes along with links to the stories that we've covered on the show as well as guests that we've had in case you want to check out a past episode. But you'll also find a drop-down menu where you can automatically subscribe to receive these episodes on your iPhone, on your iPad, your Android tablet, your laptop, your desktop, your Mac, your PC, whatever it is, in whatever format you want, we'll get it for you because, well, we love you. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter at twitter.com/PadreSJ, that's at PadreSJ. If you follow me, you'll find out what we're going to be doing for each episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, who our guests will be, and you'll be able to suggest topics for future episodes of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Don't forget that we do this show live every Friday at 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific. Just go to live.twit.tv. If you watch live, you'll see our pre-show and our post-show and everything that goes in between. It's part of making the sausage. It's what we do here because Twit's not just a show, not just a network. It's an experiment. Also, don't forget that as long as you're watching live, go ahead and jump in our chat room at irc.twit.tv and you'll be able to talk to me during the show. I've got you right up there. There's a little screen right here so that you can speak to me as the show goes on. You can ask questions and I can ask them of our guests. Again, part of the experiment that is Twit TV. I want to thank everyone else who makes the show possible, to Leo and Lisa, who allow me to do this show, to Carson, my super producer, and of course, to my TD Eskimo Zach. Zach, can you tell the folks what you do here at Twit?
Yes, I can, Padre. I like to put sunglasses on using the TriCaster, and if you want to follow me, you can follow me at Eskimo Zach on Twitter.
I give him way too much free time. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the Digital Jesuit, and remember, if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep twiet.